praise God. The man that I'm going to bring to you tonight, amen, is a man that is totally dedicated to the work of the Lord. Amen. And I don't want to put somebody, I don't want to brag, but a person that is willing to travel, amen, 1,000 miles away, amen, spend his own money just to be here, I think he's dedicated. And not only that, praise God, the Lord's been using him in our Filipino work in San Diego under the leadership of Pastor Hodges. Amen. The work there is thriving. Filipinos are just excited, amen, to be a part of this global harvest. Allow me to present to you, please shall we stand. Amen. Allow me to present to you tonight, Brother Ed Obando.
Thank you, Brother Pass. Praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord, everyone. Come on, I didn't travel all this way just to hear a mouse scream, but I want to hear the loudest praise we could give our Almighty God. Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. Praise your mighty King. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for standing. You may be seated momentarily. I just want to say it's a great privilege to be back home. It's been a while, but it's good to be home. Most of you will not understand that statement until I get further into this. Praise God. But it's just good to be home. It's good to be here. With Sir Cesar Castaño, our World Missions Director. And of course, Brother Ben Patz, our Tugon founder and organizer. And then of course, we thank God for Brother Danny being here with us, our Pacific Region Director. And I see Brother Navalio. It's good to see Sir Navalio, our superintendent, and all our brethren behind me. Appreciate them very, very much. What an awesome, awesome job that our singers did here tonight. Yes, yeah, worthy of all that. Praise God. I could easily just give an altar call just now just for what they've done in worshiping the mighty King and bringing the power of the glory of God down here. And it's just right. But I just feel the Lord's not done yet. I feel the Lord has something here for each and every minister, each and every minister's wives, and each and every their children. Hallelujah, and their workers. I truly believe that. And if you would kindly stand once again with me in the reading the Word of God. Praise God, and I do want to just acknowledge, it's good to have my sister here with me. The Philippines and her husband and her daughter, Jamie. It's just good to have them here by my side. I told her, I said, I thank God for I brought my fan club. But I thank God for my sister. She's there, the one that won me to the Lord back in 87, I believe. And I'm so thankful for that. If you would turn with me to the book of John, chapter 18 and verse 35, and we're going to jump down to verse 38. John chapter 18, verse 35, and then we're going to jump down to verse 38. Hallelujah. When God put things together, there's just an awesome presence that He puts in. In John chapter 18, verse 35, it reads, Pilate answered, Am I a Jew? Thy own nation and thy chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done? Then if you jump down to verse 38, it says, Pilate saith unto him, What is truth? And when he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews, and saith unto them, I find in him no fault at all.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you tonight. We thank you. We thank you for your lovely presence here. I thank you for the anointing that we feel. And your presence here, we thank you for that. Pray that you anoint my lips of clay to deliver your word. For we are your children. We love you and appreciate you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you for standing. You may be seated. The scriptures that we have read here tonight talks about when Judas had betrayal of Jesus. And how they take Jesus to Pilate to be judged, to be persecuted. And I could just imagine if I could, just a moment, that if I was in Jesus' place, I'd be scared stiff. I wouldn't know what I would be doing. If it was in my carnal mind, I would probably do some running. But before I ran, I would probably do some kicking. But before that, I would be shaking to my knees. And I would just be trembling. I wouldn't know what to do. Judgment's coming upon me. And things are just not going right. But see, in this stage set, something was different. We all know how powerful and awesome our Creator is. We all know what He is capable of doing. We all know that He created the earth and the universe. But in this scene that I have read here tonight, Jesus was in a predicament of what to do. But there's something different that I see here that God had opened in my eyes. That Jesus had to be here. Jesus had to stand before judgment. Jesus could have easily stopped it all, and called it quits, and just wiped them out. But yet, Jesus had to. Tonight, if I could speak to your hearts on this topic, your purpose. Your purpose. Without God, there is, if any, few coincidences. He is not a God of coincidence. He has never done anything, and I don't suppose that He would ever do or would ever will do any work without a plan. In my field of work, a plan is very important. Without those plans, you'll have thousands of men and women just confused in how to build a structure. And there's one incident when I was just sitting at work and I get a phone call from a field superintendent. They had realized in one of their homes that we were remodeling, that they were ready to cut open a concrete slab. And in a concrete slab, there are three types we design in the States. And in those three types, you have your standard concrete slab, your standard 4-inch thick in a single-story home. And then on a two-story home, you have a 6-inch slab of pure concrete. And then there's the other slab, which is called with the rebar, with steel inside the concrete. It's just steel that just laid and is formed, and when they pour the concrete, it's hardened and it's thick. And they usually use this type of foundation and structure where the soil is not so stable, maybe on a hillside. But yet there's another form of slab they use. It's called post-tension slab. And what that is almost like rebar, but it's used cables. Cables are placed in concrete before it's hardened. And once it starts to begin to harden, they pull and stretch those cables to a strength of about 1,700 pounds PSI, pounds per square inch. If one of those cables was to snap or was cut and broken, it would literally cut the slab in two with a clean cut. And our cable would literally shoot from here all the way to maybe 5 or 6 or 7 city blocks. He could literally cut a person in half without him even notice that he's been cut. In a twinkle of an eye, he's dead. But church, let me tell you, it is a plan that has been designed. It is a precise plan. That type of structure is placed in a location near the ocean. And so these particular foundations are placed strategically in a situation that is suited for. God is a God of plan. God is a God of order. Hallelujah. But everything I find Him doing in the Word of the Lord and in my personal life, in the life of others that I have observed, He does it with purpose. He does it with a purpose and a plan. My God is a God of order. The first recorded work that we have of our God is the work of creation. And if you will observe the work of creation, you will become convinced that the Creator who made all things did it with a purpose and a plan. In the United States, we have seasons. We have the four seasons. We have winter, spring, summer, and fall. And during the fall, you can see the leaves of the tree turn brown. And soon enough, towards the end of the fall season, they'll start falling into the ground and they turn brown and nothing green. But yet when spring hits, they bloom, they blossom. And next you know, that ugly looking branch tree only would blossom tree, leaves and flowers. It become gorgeous and beautiful and it becomes colorful. And those are the seasons we have in the United States. And then viewing the creation in the most simplistic way, you could come convinced in the fact that God is a God of order. The sun rises in the morning and it sets in the evening. It shines in the daytime and the stars and the moon at night. And the day comes and the night comes. And the season of the year is there ordained in cycles. God is a God of plan. God's creation was not just thrown out there just to happen as it will. God just didn't say this is what's going to happen. And He just didn't throw it out there and just hodgepodge it. And in the summer, it's not going to be cold. In the winter, it's not going to be hot. But God has created in a perfect plan. Hallelujah. He manifests Himself. He is a God of organization and order. Hallelujah. Even in the creation of the world, in dealing with humanity throughout the scripture, He has dealt with man according to a plan. In whatever era of time it was that He dealt with man, He did it in a particular plan. There's a manner in which blood, faith, and obedience could be manifest, and the salvation and the redemption could be obtained in the part of the human race. Hallelujah. In the beginning, the work of God in my life, if I may share a testimony with you of how God dealt with me in such a young age. At the age 6, God had moved us to the United States. And God, then after 30 years, did I only return home to the Philippines. After 30 years. But see, at age 6, I've learned Tagalog very small amount. But then within that 30 years, I've learned English and the rest of my life. I've forgotten my language. I don't know what the type of food was. I didn't know the culture. I didn't know the language. I had to adapt to the food once again as I got older. And as I learned the language, as I heard the language, the more I wanted to learn my language. And the more I got in my heart, in my soul, that I wanted to learn Tagalog. I went in the library, picked up some Tagalog dictionaries and some Tagalog comic books. I felt that would be the easiest way to learn my language. But yet, of no success, I still spoke English. My Lord, waiting for a miracle in my life. But see, that was the beginning work of God. But see, at that age, until up to my 30s, I didn't understand it. Until God has started working and dealing with me. Hallelujah. And it's this earthly ministry as he walked on the face of this earth. In the flesh, we witness the Lord is a God of order. To take God with a plan. There was not a lot of happen instances. There was not coincidences. He knew where he was going. And he knew what he was going to do. And he was full of mission. That was full of purpose. He didn't just begin anything without a plan. He knew the ending. He always knew the end. From the beginning, this was one of our traits of our God. I am so thankful that he was not finished with me in my young age and in my life. I am so thankful he saw not what I was, but what I can be. I am so thankful that my sister had found the Lord and that she had witnessed to me. I see him as he makes his way that eventful day of the fourth chapter of John to Jacob's well. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but I do not feel that he just happened to have arrived at that moment. I just don't feel that it just happened to decide to pass through Samaria and just happened to come to Jacob's well about the time when a woman came who was desperate for help and desperate for direction and desperate for answer. I am convinced, knowing the God that we serve, when he arose that morning, he began his journey for that day. He knew he was going to Jacob's well, and he knew that the time that he would show and get there in just in a short little while before she would arrive, that the woman would arrive. He knew he had to arrive there earlier than her. He knew he would speak to her, and he knew he would present truth to her in a fashion that she had never heard before in her life. I don't think when he arose that morning, he began to walk in the streets of Jericho, that he was just passing through another city, seeing new faces and shaking hands that he has just never shaken before. But I think when he arose that morning, he knew precisely where he was going, because he was a God that had allowed the seed of that sycamore tree to go to the wings of the wind and fall to the earth on the side of that road many years before that day. He was a God that saw it all. He was a God that saw to it that the sycamore tree would not get enough sunlight, that would get enough rain, that the children did not trample over the seed of that sycamore. He knew he placed that tree in a precise location, and he knew that he was going to use that tree one day for a young boy to climb up that tree, for Jesus just to look up and speak to Zacchaeus. He knew all this. It was his perfect plan. Hallelujah. He had ordained that tree being
there. And he knew what when he arrived at that appointed place, there would be a man by the name of Zacchaeus who had a desire in his heart to see Jesus. This good man, he knew exactly what limb he would be sitting on. He is a God of order, and he is a God with a plan. Hallelujah. He knew it all. It was a perfect plan. It was a strategic that he placed just for a certain time and a certain moment. One day in our service at South Bay United Pentecostal Church in San Diego, the awesome presence of God had moved in a mighty way. There was no preaching. There was all worship. We sang. We danced in the Spirit. God spoke to us in a mighty way. And God convicted. And God made calling. God poured out His Spirit as many spoke in tongues. As the Holy Ghost came. And many was baptized in the wonderful name of Jesus. In that service, in that same particular service, only about two to three months ago, God dealt with me again in my heart. God was convicting me. God was calling in my heart. He was just there into my heart. I just felt that He was just doing an operation. I was laying there. I was speaking to Him, and He moved. As I wept, as I cried, as I moved up to the altar, there was fear and trembling. I approached my pastor. I said, "Pastor, God's dealing with me." And I for sure thought He was dealing with me here in the Philippines. And I told him, "God," I told him, "Pastor, I don't know what it is. I don't know if God's calling me here to the Philippines or God is just dealing with my heart with the Filipinos in South Bay, in San Diego." He said, "Brother Ed, let's go to our knees and pray." As the minister laid their hands on me, we began to pray. God came down in a mighty way again, and the Holy Ghost just fell. And my pastor, we left it like this: "Brother Ed, go home and pray and seek God. Let's seek the perfect plan. Let's seek the perfect will. If so be it, God's going to deal with your wife. God's going to deal with your children. God's going to deal with your work. God's going to deal with everything around you." As I went home, my wife and I would talk, and I would share this burden with her, and then she didn't feel it. I said, "God, am I missing something?" And then I spoke with my children, and my son, a 12-year-old boy, he's going, "God," he goes, "Dad, if you're ready to go, I'll go." But yet my 7-year-old, I just saw it in him. He just didn't want to go. And then my wife, she just didn't feel it. I said, "God, you said you're going to talk to my wife and my children, if this is your will." And so I went back to my altar, the prayer, seeking God. And God was not done yet. I didn't get my answer that day, or that night, nor that week, nor that month. And then again, another service came, and God moved in a mighty way. And then God spoke, and I just want to leave it right there. I now understand the purpose that the God started in my life. And this is the time when I knew that the purpose, the potential, and the leadership that God had dealt in my heart. And when He got to that sycamore tree, He didn't just casually happen to look up into that tree and saw Zacchaeus and began His conversation with him. But He knew He would be there. And I believe that He knew that Zacchaeus was going to be there. And it was not, this is not my message tonight, but I wonder what the thrill was like when Zacchaeus suddenly understood and realized that Jesus, the righteous man, and this good man who had power to heal the sick, that Jesus sees him up in the tree. Church, that night in that service, I realized that Jesus had saw me, that Jesus was dealing with me once again. And there's a purpose why he took me out in the Philippines at a young age, only to live in the States for 30 years to learn the English language, to learn the English way. But there's a purpose in my life, and there's a calling that began, and there was a restructuring in my life, and God began to deal with me that I need to learn my language. I picked up the book once again, and I understood it more and more and more. And then God placed a woman in my life, and that I'm married to this day, a natural born Filipina. She knew the language well. She cooked the food very well, as I have evidence right here. Hallelujah. But yet, she was determined to teach me my language. She said, you need to learn her language. You are not gonna hold my hand. You are not gonna marry me. Then she was my fiance. You are not gonna marry me until you learn a little bit of language, a little bit of Filipino, and you need to learn the type of food that I eat. I said, that's a well plan for me. That's good for me. Lord, you placed her in my life. That's gotta be it. And so therefore, this is when I began to see the work of God. And God reminded me then of the beginning of the work he placed in my heart. Ministers, Jesus sees you. He sees your potential. He sees your purpose. He sees your leadership. He sees your church. He sees your congregation. He sees it all. He has a plan. There's a purpose why he placed you in your church. There's a reason and a purpose why he placed people in your hands. It is a reason and there's a purpose why you are here tonight in this to go ministry. There's a reason and a purpose. There's a perfect plan for each and every soul that's here tonight. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. He sees you in your local churches. He sees the souls that you have been trying to restore. And church, he sees your heartaches. He sees the souls that you are reaching out to. He sees your purpose. He sees your potential. He sees your leadership. Jesus sees it all. He saw it even before you got to the church that you are pastoring. He even saw the backsliders before they backslid. He saw the true worshipers in your church when they were just sinners. He saw them. He saw the broken marriage before they were even married. Hallelujah. He saw it all. But there are things that he just allows to happen. He saw the givers, the faithful givers, when they had no job. Hallelujah. Then one day, as he was walking around here in the Philippines, he looked up and saw you ministers. He spoke to you with a purpose. He spoke to you with your potentials. He spoke to you regarding your leadership. Jesus had saw you. Hallelujah. I hope you understand by now that the God that we serve is a God of ordained a plan. He is a God of the perfect will. He is a God of organization. He is a God that placed you in a particular time and in a particular place with particular people. Hallelujah. Your purpose, your potential, your leadership. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When he got to that sycamore tree, he went there on purpose. He went there with a plan. I don't only think that the acts of God and the work of God are carried out according to purpose and according to a plan, but I am thoroughly convinced today, tonight, that there is a perfect, absolute will of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the life of every man and every woman and every children. Hallelujah. I believe that if we submit ourselves to the direction of the Spirit of God in our lives, and there is a beginning point and an ending point. And I believe that everyone here tonight, God has a plan for your life. God has a plan for your ministry. God has a plan for your city. God has a plan for your purpose. God has a plan for your potentials. God has a plan for your leadership. God has a perfect, absolute will plan. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's love the Lord. Let's praise Him. Let's magnify Him. Praise God. I can't think of anything that would be more dissatisfying to think that it just happens to be there. How awful would it be to say, oh God, just happened to place me here. I don't want to think that way. But I want to say, God, there was a purpose why you left, why you had took me out of here at the age of 6. There was a purpose that for after 30 years that I would return to the Philippines. And now I understand. I went back to my pastor and I said, Pastor, I feel it now. I know what it is. And my pastor had a big smile in his face. I said, Pastor, the Lord wants me to do the work here in San Diego, and that I need to be here with my brethren in San Diego. And he hugged me and said, that was the perfect, absolute will of God. And I didn't understand it again because I'm a Filipino, wanted to come home. But that's the flesh. And I understand now as I look amongst us and I look behind me, there are ministers here already in the Philippines to reach out to our countrymen. There are Filipino ministers here already reaching out. God said, we don't need another one from here. But God wanted me to learn my language. And I thank God for that. I'm able to teach Tagalog, Bible study in San Diego. I'm able to sing Tagalog song with my brethren in San Diego. I'm able to eat the type of food that everyone eat here in the Philippines. My stomach had adjusted to the food. My wife, when she cooks the exact food that I would find here in the Philippines. She said, you'll need this so that when you get there, there'll be no difference. It'll be exactly the same thing. And Lord and behold, this is exactly the same thing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I must believe, I must have confidence today that God is a God of plan and God has a will going to bring us to leadership. Hallelujah. Purpose would give us the desire. Purpose would give us that desire to lead us to our actions. Our actions is what's going to bring the souls to this altar. Actions is what's going to bring us to prayer. Actions is going to lead us to worship. Hallelujah. Church, we need to bring the true worshipers up to speed. We need to teach them even more and more and more. We need to teach our altar workers to work the altars even more and more. We need to teach our people to teach more Bible studies even more and more. Church, we need to be leaders to our own people, to our congregation. God will give you a purpose that will give you that desire that will then lead you to your action, to your home church. Hallelujah. 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 If we could all stand, if we could all stand and see God's face. God, you are the God of plan. You are God of organization. You are God of no confusion. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Church, let's seek God right now. Let's lift up our hands and praise Him. Let's ask God to put the purpose in our hearts. Let's ask God to give us that desire that will lead us into action. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, church. Magnify God. Worship God. Seek God after for your own salvation. Seek God for your own plan. Seek God for your own purpose. Seek God tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's worship Him, God. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Come on, let's praise the Lord tonight. Let's lift up the name of Jesus.